So Christine is beginning to understand the idea of growing older and that that will mean changes for her. Just this past week, she has asked me, "Daddy, when are my teeth going to fall out?" She said, "Daddy, when am I going to learn how to drive?" Reminding me that I need to practice with her. And then she said, April's going to marry Tim, his little boy. She said, "Daddy, we need to have Austin over to watch a movie and have a little date."
Oh, no.
And then she asked me, this is all this week, "Daddy, why are you so big?" I said, "Well, because I'm older than you." She thought for a second. She said, "Daddy, you're too old." She said, "Look at that big booty." I'm not kidding. She said, "Oh, Daddy, it's saggy and baggy and wrinkly." And I went, "That's Sarah." She laughed at me too. Today, I want to talk to you about, and we're going to start into a series on discipleship and growth as a Christian. Because what happens sometimes in churches is we can easily spend most of our time trying to encourage people that you must be saved, believe in Jesus, and encouraging them to take that first step of faith. And then we give them the impression that you just like say this prayer and you go back to your old life. You know, what happens after day one is so important. And so I'd remind you as we start into this, a few things. One, Jesus did not go around asking random people, "Hey, do you believe I'm the Messiah?" "Yes, okay, you're good. You know, go back." No, he went around telling people, "Hey, you follow me." And then later, you know, the whole question of his identity came up. But primarily, he's going around and he's making these disciples and he's telling them, "Hey, you follow me." So when I talk to people about their faith, usually I like that language. Not just, "Are you a believer? Are you a, do you identify yourself as a Christian? Are you a follower of Jesus?" Because it implies that it is like something that is continuing in your life. It's not some decision you made when you were 8. It is a daily commitment to follow him. In addition, Jesus, he never used the word Christian. He called people to be his disciples. Now, the word Christian came about later in the church in Antioch, and it was actually kind of an insult. It meant something like mini Christ. And the people around them like couldn't believe that these people wanted so badly to be like that executed criminal in their eyes. So they kind of poked fun at them. "You guys are a bunch of, you know, mini Christs." He called people to be his disciples. Now, the word disciple, it means that, and they had disciples back then, the Jewish rabbis, they would have people who would follow them with the aim of conforming their lives to the pattern of the teacher. So in conversation with the Pharisees, they described themselves as the disciples of Moses. So last week, we talked about a verse in 2 Peter. Talked about a verse in 2 Peter. There we go. Right. 2 Peter 3:18. "But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen." And so there's this idea that yes, you're to put your faith in Jesus and his forgiveness is complete from day one. But after that point, there is an expectation of you've got to be growing. We went through this really stressful time when Christine was very young. Parents, are you familiar with what this is, a growth curve? And so you go to the doctor and they say, you're like, you know, the upper and lower, that's like 95% of all kids. This is how old or how big they are compared to their age. We went through this period with Christine where she was like a pound below the 2% mark. And it was just so stressful. Every time we go to the doctor, we were so worried that, oh, you know, she's not growing like she could. Is this an indication that something is seriously wrong? And here's the thing. Some of you, you know, you believed in the Lord maybe at a very young age, but man, since then, like maybe, you know, you went to Sunday school for a while and it's just like a flat line. And you know, ask yourself and say, like, man, you know, compare yourself like maybe 10 years ago. 10 years ago to today, how is my faith and understanding and faithfulness and service to God, is it different than it was then? And what does the shape of my life look like? Jesus made disciples. Disciples grow. Now we continue his work in our text for today. If you have your Bibles, open to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. Now, throughout this chapter, to kind of follow the thoughts leading up to this, he describes how Jesus, after he came back from the dead, Jesus left the disciples. So he died on the cross, he comes back to life, and the disciples are like, oh great, you know, are you going to bring your kingdom now? And then he's like, actually, I'm leaving you. And he puts them in charge, and so it talks about the job that Jesus passed on to his followers. He gave them gifts. So Ephesians chapter 4, we'll start at verse 11. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. Now this has always been of interest to me, of course, because it gives like a two-word job description for myself as a pastor. Jesus returns to heaven. He left people to continue his work. Now, there's a really big difference that you have to catch here in this verse. That he is not saying that Jesus left the pastors to do the work of service. He's not saying that. He's saying that he left pastors and teachers and evangelists and these people in leadership, they are to equip you to do it. It's not about Jesus creating some few superstars in the church and they're the ones who go out and do all of the great work for him. Pastors are not like some high-dollar quarterback who goes and they say, we're going to put the load of the team on your back. We're much more like general managers or a coach. And so we equip you to do the work of the service. And the result of this is that it says the body of Christ, which is you, the church, may be built up. Now, there are all kinds of seminars out there that will talk about church growth. And when people think about, okay, you know, if we want to see the church grow, a lot of times they think in terms of numbers. But here, I think the sense is very different. The body of Christ is built up when you are equipped for service and when you grow. And growth doesn't always mean in size. You know, throughout this past year, in part because of comments like the one Christine made to me about my size, you know, I've been spending a lot of time in physical fitness. I actually weigh exactly as much now as I did when I started about a year and a half ago. But composition, hopefully, is different. I took a before and after picture. Slightly different. Okay, and sometimes that's what the church looks like. You can have a church that, like, numerically, attendance-wise, is exactly the same 1 year to the next. But during that year, you can have tremendous growth if the individuals become more dedicated to Christ. They grow in their knowledge and faithfulness and their excitement in what God is doing. Now, this isn't the kind of bodybuilding that he had in mind when he said, you know, the body of Christ will be built up. But again, it is important to remember that growth in the church can have two dimensions, both numerically and as we make disciples. I would rather begin by making disciples.
Yes.
And then those disciples go on to make more disciples. That is how the church grows. Now, this is a slow process, and we don't see it happen overnight. But here's how he defines that process. So this is stopping in verse 12. In verse 13, he says, so this happens, the body of Christ is built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. There is a goal to our growth. Here he describes it as we grow into unity, and I would say that's not only our church working well with each other, playing nice with others, but also the church larger. I would love to see the church in Thayer and Mammoth, all of the churches grow and experience more and more of that unity. So we grow in our unity with each other as believers and in our knowledge of Jesus. And then there's this idea of maturity. And the Greek word there is teleos, which means to be brought to completion and not lacking anything. Now, this maturity in Christ is not something that happens when we first believe. Just as thankfully, human babies are not born fully developed adults. I can say amen to that. And it also isn't complete sinless perfection. We'll have to wait until heaven for that. But in the in-between time, while we're here, from the day that I first believe until the day that I die, God expects to see a change in me. This idea of maturity. Paul describes this as his goal for the church, Colossians chapter 1. Talks about Jesus. He is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. To this end, I strenuously contend with all the energy Christ so powerfully works in me. So he says, look, my goal is not just to baptize a lot of people. My goal is not just to reach the lost and introduce them to Jesus. He definitely talks about that. But he says, look, I also want to present you not as just infants, but I want to present all of you as people who are fully, who are complete and whole in their faith and practice. I don't want to just see people saved. I want to see people grow towards maturity. We were so happy when Mitchell was born. And he's really cute. But man, I hope he gets beyond this phase he's in right now. Like, y'all, last night was just wretched. And he just kept waking up. It was worse for Sarah than it was for me. And, you know, just kept waking up and waking up. And we expect for him to grow. I want to see him grow and not just be a cute baby. I want to see him grow into a man and go and do things with his life. God wants the same with us. What does it mean to be mature? How can I become that complete person in Christ? Now, that's the big question of my generation, right? Like, when am I an adult? You guys, people around my age, you guys have gone through that questioning of, you know, you're not a teenager. You're like, is it when I graduated high school? When I got my first job, am I now an adult? Or when I got married, I had a goatee there. And a ponytail. When I got married, am I an adult now? Or when I graduated college? Is it when I bought a house? And man, you feel sick signing a loan on that. Was it when we had kids? Let me just tell you, young people, you do those things in that order.
Yes.
And your life will be blessed. A lot easier. Or maybe I became an adult when I stopped buying cereal marketed by cartoon characters. I just find myself eating stuff that advertises itself as high in fiber. Christine asked me, I said, that's daddy's sad cereal. Sad, responsible adult cereal. So here he defines maturity. That's back in Ephesians 4:13. I'll read it for you. Until we all reach unity in the faith and knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. So he defines maturity as Jesus Christ. We are to look like Jesus. That is what maturity is defined by. That is the measure that we use. So you look at yourself and you say, okay, do I look like Jesus? It is not measured by how long you have been saved. So sometimes we think about that, right? Yeah, people tell me, like, oh, I've been going to church, for 30, 40, 50, however many years. That is not an indication of your maturity. Because I have met people who have been in the church from, like, day one and are still infants in their understanding of God. And then I've met people who, like, later in life or at some point, man, God hits them and their eyes are open, they accept Christ, and it's like a rocket. I mean, they just grow, and every time you see them, they're learning, they're serving, they're growing closer to God, and they do not stop and they do not look back. And sometimes I watch them just blowing by, like, not even looking back at the people who've been in church their whole lives. So maturity is not defined by how long you have been a Christian. It's also not defined in your comparison to other people. You know, have you ever done like those sword drills, right, kids do? Like, I'm going to call out a passage, and whoever can find the first in their Bible and, you know, stand up and wave the Bible in the air. I mean, I could do that, and some of you might say, oh, I can find the passages faster than everybody because I have a Bible app. But worrying if you are more godly than the next person is never helpful because you're not being measured to their standard. The standard, what God is growing you into, is not the person sitting next to you. It's Jesus Christ. Now, there's not also, like, really a test I can give you. I wish I could, like, refer you. Would you like to see if you're mature in Christ? Go to BuzzFeed, and they'll tell you, you know, which of the disciples you are, or, you know, how mature you are. There's not a set test for this. But we are aiming for the standard of Jesus in every way. A mature Christian, every day, looks more and more like Jesus. So verse 14. He compares it to the other extreme. He says, so we grow into maturity, we begin to resemble Christ, then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people and their deceitful scheming. So what defines an infant, somebody who is not grown in their faith? And here it's the idea of instability. Somebody's just blown here and blown there, and they have no foundation. I think of, like, when Christine, you know, was first, like, learning to walk, and toddlers do that, like, little run, and you're surprised they're not falling down every other step. And then she, like, see the dog come running around the corner, and she braces herself to get knocked over. And so in doctrine, in terms of what we believe, people who are infants have no stability. Like, they basically believe whatever it is the last Christian book they've read. And I've met people, and sometimes, you know, people very excited about Jesus, but also, like, really young in the faith, like, you know, like a year or less. And I talk to them for a little bit, and I, like, walk away from the conversation being like, you know, bless his heart. He has some really weird ideas about God right now. And you can't blame them because, I mean, they're like, you know, I haven't even read the Bible yet. And they're just like, oh, everything is so exciting. And basically what they believe about God is just whatever they happen to pick up. And they're really like, this is so great. And then, like, later on, we look back at those times and like, oh, I can't believe, you know, like, I really believed that about God. And he says that they're blown here and there by winds of teaching. And here's the truth, that there are cunning and crafty people who set out to deceive. Sometimes it is intentional. And here's the truth about the state of the church in America. I was reading this article, and they're talking about it. It was in 2014. And they just pointed out, here's the reality of the church in America. This is the 2014 bestseller list. So they're like, here's what's in the top 10 of Christian books. You've got a secular relationship book, a finance book, a diet book, a bunch of really unbiblical books, and one Christian book in the top 10. And they're like, here's what's selling. You know, about half the books have nothing to do with Jesus whatsoever, and about the other half are really incredibly, not, like, not nitpicking, these are really horrible theology. And you've got, like, one sound book, and it happens to be the guy who owns Lifeway, who wrote the book, whose job it is to sell you all of the diet books and the, you know, the bad theology books. It's his book. And so, like, the answer, you know, for you in this is not to come with me. Pastor Aaron, I just got this book. What do you think of it? Pastor, and I could give you, like, an approved list of books as they come out. Thou shalt read this, and thou shalt not read this. No, the answer is for you to grow in maturity, for you to develop what's called discernment. You spend time in the Word, and you will recognize what lines up with it and what doesn't. I was tempted to, like, start the message out, and because some of you, like, you have no basis for knowing truth from fiction, and, like, for me to just start out and spew progressively worse, like, heresies, and just see, like, how long it took for you to, like, be uncomfortable, or, like, until you physically dragged me off stage. I did that with some students, and I've really pushed the limit with this, because I wanted to hammer home from them the point that you can't just trust everything you hear. And so I did this. They were high school students, and I said, hey guys, I want to expand your faith, and so I'm going to teach you a Muslim prayer today. And you guys are going to say, I want you to connect to God through this. And they're like, okay. And I said, now you're going to say the words, I'm going to repeat it in Arabic, and you guys are going to say the words. And they said, no, all of you, say the words in Arabic. And they all, and I was begging myself inside, somebody say something. Somebody say, like, actually, no, I'm not okay. All of them did it. And they're repeating after me. I'm waiting. Like, I'm a youth pastor. I'm waiting for somebody to walk around. I'm like, man, I'm going to get fired for this. And then finally, so uncomfortable. Finally, it's like, all right, guys, actually, in order to do this, I want us all, we're going to kneel on the floor and face Mecca. And they were getting off the sofas. And I couldn't take it anymore. I was like, what are you doing? This is so insane. And at that point, they're like, oh, Pastor, I was really uncomfortable. I was like, why didn't you say anything? Don't be like that. Letting people blow you here and there. You've got to stand up. And I told, like, one of the student leaders, like, you know, here's what's going to happen beforehand. She said, Pastor Aaron, I've never been so uncomfortable all my life. Look, I want you to be grounded, that you know what you know, to be so fixed on the gospel and so sure of who God is, that if you're introduced to false teaching or ideas, you instantly recognize it and are able to stand firm against it. But understand, everybody starts out this way. I'll say everybody starts out as an infant. Because I talk to people frequently who are, like, new to church life. And they feel this self-awareness of, like, Pastor Aaron, I don't feel like I know as much as the other people. Like, I don't know about going to Bible study because the people there know a lot of stuff that I don't. Everybody starts out this way. There's not a person on this planet that, when they were first introduced to the gospel, said, like, Jesus, I believe, and, like, boom, theology. It doesn't happen that way. And so the question for you today is not to say, oh, I feel good because I feel like I am mature, I've reached this level of growth. My question for you is, where is your life headed? It's not, you know, what your current level of maturity is what is the trajectory of your life. 1 Corinthians 14:20, brothers and sisters, stop thinking like children. In regard to evil, be infants, but in your thinking, be adults. Some of you, it is time for you to grow up. It's time for you to grow up.
Yes, it is.
You know, you're not a child anymore. And some of you you've been knowing the Lord long enough, and it is time for you to move beyond childish things. And to illustrate that, let me just do a stunt for you real quick. I'm training for this. You guys ready? Ready. If Mitchell did that, we would take a video and post it on. He rolled over for the first time. Because doing that for an infant, that's impressive, right? You remember, your child hits that milestone, yeah! A full-grown adult do that. You guys are like, he has lost his same mind. It is time for you to grow up. Alright? Right? There are things that would be acceptable for somebody 2 days into Jesus that you have in your life that it is time for you to put behind you. All right? It is time to grow up. Don't be out of center. This personal thing here, I cannot stand. The movies that this guy makes, if you don't know, like, every single one of his movies, he plays the same character, and it is the man-child. It is somebody who, in terms of how long he's been alive, is at the point of being an adult, but has the maturity level of, like, a 10-year-old. This is not okay, church. Don't be that kind of Christian, stuck in a perpetual state of childishness. It is time for you to press on. Don't sit in that state of ignorance. Again, if this is a reality check for you, the answer is to press in. Like, man, my first day at Bible college was so humiliating. You know, because I was pretty new, you know, in the faith. I felt very clearly like God's called me to preach, and I've got to be prepared. And I go in, and it's like, man, everybody here, you know, they're generally older, and they've been walking with the Lord a long time, and they're like quoting scripture off the top of their head. Like, how do you even do that? And they know all this stuff, and I felt so stupid and so inadequate. But the answer was not for me to say, you know what, I can't do this. People go to the gym and say, oh, I don't look like the people here. Let me stay home. It's like somebody going to school and saying, well, I don't know as much as the teacher. Let me stay home. So let me tell you, if we have a wonderful adult study here every Wednesday night at 6:30. And if you come here, now, Ms. Karen will teach that, and you may say, well, I don't know as much as the other people, then that's the place that you need to be. Yes. You may say, Pastor Aaron, I don't know the Bible like other people do. Well, you have one, and it's available in a language that you understand. Take advantage of it. It is time for you to grow up. God will give you the strength. Ephesians 4:15. Instead of being childish, instead of being an infant, just tossed here and there by everything that comes along, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of Him who is the head, that is Christ. In every respect. I want to be possessed by the love that Jesus showed to His friends. I would love to have His level of knowledge and understanding of the Scriptures. I would love to walk in the power that He showed in His daily life. I would love to have His level of trust with the Father, that no matter what the Father commanded, that He would do. I want to grow up in every respect to be more like Him. Maybe you've had a childhood hero, somebody you grew up looking up to. So I don't be like that person. I've had it before, you know, like I said, you know, being a youth pastor, like, you know, going in there and, you know, kids look up to you and they come in and they're like, cut their hair like mine. I'm going to have that attitude towards Jesus. I have everything about Him.
Yes.
I want to grow up. Now, some people, and I think it's worth saying, some people would define maturity as they begin to grow in knowledge. They stray from this idea. They would define maturity as, well, I learned all that stuff about the cross and grace and forgiveness when I was a child. And they say, well, like adulthood, in terms of the faith, means I go off on these really bizarre tangents and study all kinds of like obscure stuff about the end times or these really weird pockets of theology, and they're like obsessed with like the trivia. And let me just tell you, the maturity in Christ never departs from Christ Himself. Now, you may go on to amass a great deal of knowledge or service or whatever it is, but it is always going to be centered on Christ. It's going to have its foundations in grace and on the cross. You never, like, outgrow that. I don't care how long you've been in church. The sacrifice of Jesus is always relevant to your life. And it is always the center of our faith. If you're not having that as the center, if you're not focused on Christ, you're just growing a tumor. It's not something that is directed and founded in Him. So here's my prayer for you today. And again, it's not about us like doing some kind of survey or maturity test. It's not for you to sit here and feel guilty because, man, I like plateaued for 30 years. My question for you today is, what are you going to set out to do? And I would hope that nobody says, like, I am mature enough. Like, I've got this much of Jesus, and that's about enough for me. My prayer for you is that you would long so much to know him more, to be closer to him, that year after year after year, you would see that growth in your life. Let's pray. God, you call us to grow closer to you, and it is for our own good. God, we may grow in many other things, in our skill in performing our job. We may become more knowledgeable of certain things as we study. We may train our bodies and grow in that area, but what is there in this world that could be better than growing closer to you? That you would mold us into your image. That we would not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of our minds. God, I pray that for the individuals here and as a church and as a whole, that we would become not just people who will say your name or wear a title, but your disciples becoming like you. In Jesus' name.